Woman. Blonde woman. Kilt-Man. Kilt-Man wants woman. Kilt-Man want this woman. Make spear go hard. Kilt-Man from Bone Age.
Hey, folks. Kilt-Man here. Kilt-Man, that's your spear-wielding service. How are you all?
Hope you're well. Yes. You encounter me in Shaggy Mane Zone. Oh. The gods of YouTube have bestowed upon me the sacred fire water. We must pray to it, bow down to it, and then imbibe of it. Yeah. Guys, how are you all? Now, if you saw my previous video, I was reviewing the Italian exploitation, Stone Age meets Iron Age, action, sleaze flick, Iron Master. And I loved it. But whilst watching it, the tale of a good guy from one tribe gets outcast and banished, meets another tribe who are a bit more sophisticated, learns from them, teaches them, interactions between the two tribes ensue, all hell breaks loose, and the dawn of a new tribe is witnessed. Plus they discover iron as well, the whole point of the film. But the film, it definitely reminds you of when you're sitting there watching it and laughing at the big bad hairdos, which is Rich coming from me, is Hammer's 1966 fantastic epic man versus dinosaurs, woman versus man versus dinosaurs versus fair lined bikinis. Raquel Welch, come on now. John Richardson, absolutely classic. 1 million years BC. To this day, that is still Hammer's, or certainly one of Hammer's biggest grossing and most successful movies out of all their tenure. You know, Frankenstein, Dracula, all that sort of stuff. You know, the mummy movies, what have you. This Stone Age man fighting big, stop motion dinosaurs, that is what made it. That's what made all the moolah for Hammer. Fabulous movie. It's actually written by Hammer's head honcho, Michael Carreras, and he based it on the original 1940s version, which was just called 1 million BC, which starred, of all people, Victor Mature and Lon Chaney Jr. And his version, the Hammer version, is pretty much, I would say word for word, but there's not many words in it, pretty much a very faithful retake on it, but with much improved special effects and a far prettier cast. And it's one of those films which, you know, people of a certain age, you grew up with this, and it was spellbinding. Ray Harryhausen stuff anyway, the Sinbad movies, you know, you just, Talos, the Harpies, come on now. Harryhausen, and Hammer actually working with Harryhausen, and on location, the entirety of the movie, apart from some interior set in caves, which were done at Elstree Studios, was done in the Canary Islands, Lanzarote, Tenerife, you know, Gran Canaria. These are volcanic islands, and once they got there, the cast and crew would up sticks and camp up in the highlands. Oh my God, and what a landscape that they're working with. The film opens with a narration. This is the morning of mankind, the dawn of time. Of course, anachronistically, man never existed beside those great big deadly dragon things. You know, yes, the big deadly lizards, dinosaurs. It didn't happen. And in one brief shot, you actually see a huge tarantula as well. Sadly, although is it sadly because I'm an arachnophobe, but it would have made great eerie scene. But they never actually fight that tarantula. He just threw it in there just for a little sort of aside. But the plot, like Iron Master, is, you know, an outcast from one tribe does encounter another tribe who have a different way of life, a different society, his barbaric ways will be honed and refined by their ways. He will also teach them sort of how to be a bit more aggressive when need be. And at the end of it all, with one of those fabulous great big volcanic eruptions, which throughout all these movies, and this one pretty much started it, let's be honest, but all the Doug McClure, At the Earth's Core, Warlords of Atlantis, The Land That Time Forgot, all that sort of thing, they would always end with a huge volcanic eruption and the island would sink and the survivors would just get away in the last boat or raft or whatever. Likewise in this, after all the confrontations and the titanic struggles that they go through, a new tribe will be built at the end in the shadow of this huge volcanic eruption and destruction, which has laid waste to all the bad ones, the bad people. But let's just break this film down, because this is an absolute classic. As a kid, you grew up with these movies. People who don't know them are going to look back on these or look into these and just go, Jesus Christ, what are you on about? This is so tacky. Just people grunting, rolling around in the dirt and waggling spears at things which clearly, when they're acting, aren't there. Although I will say, the choreography and the sight lines and the interaction between live action, live actors, and superimposed or matted together stop motion animation or even live creatures is possibly the best that Harryhausen did. Yeah, and I'm also thinking of Clash of the Titans, and which came many, many years later. But in this, he really did achieve something great. Harryhausen always said that, I never want to do what the cheaper people do, the cheaper effects guys do, where they get real lizards and put fake fins and spines on them and have them lumbering across and have people running from them. I don't want to do that. And yet, in this, the very first creature that you see is like a lizard, a Gila monster or whatever you call him, and he's put fins and spines on it. But he always said, I didn't want to do that, but the idea behind it was like, okay, I'm going to give audiences a creature that people are familiar with, people think they've seen before, and I'll make it look a bit fantastical, and then I'm going to bring, pterodons in, and orosauruses and other stuff, triceratops. I'm going to bring all those in, and we're going to have lots of battles and frenzies and carnage. And you definitely get your money's worth out of it. So, Pretty Boy, BG wannabe, John Richardson plays Tumak. And Tumak is part of the Rock Tribe. Yeah, and these are hairy, heathen, barbarian bastards, these are, But with John Richardson there, he was a good-looking fella. Even under that big facial rug and that huge shaggy hair, which actually is very similar to what I am bedecked with right now. He was a good-looking fella. He's got piercing baby blues. He looks like Franco Nero. And definitely, after making this, in later years, Italian exploitation would drag John Richardson over into their tenure, under their stable, and he'd make a lot of sleazy giallo and horror pics, probably because he did have a look of Franco Nero. There you go. Everything's connected. And he's wonderful. He's brick hard. He and Percy Herbert, yes, who is a lot of these people in this movie are stalwarts of British drama, TV, Hammer movies, and wartime dramas. And you don't expect to see them with shaggy hair and, with their chests exposed and little fairy loincloths and strap-overs, You don't expect to see that. But it works, and they are giving it their all. Percy Herbert and John Richardson, Tumak and Santala, I think he's called, do not get on. Sibling rivalry, folks. And their father, the chieftain of the Rock Tribe, is, I forget this guy's name, I'll break it down, Robert Brown. Robert Brown played M, James Bond's boss, M, in the Bond movies Octopussy Till License to Kill. Yep. M has got his boobies, his moves out, his prehistoric moves. And he's a savage bastard. He really is, And, after a boar hunt and then the party in their caves, where you've got Martine Beswick, who I discussed at length in the Hammer, classic Hammer movie, Dr. Jekyll and Sister Hyde. Why am I looking at you? As if you know the answer. and a lot of other Hammer movies. And she'd just done Slave Girls, aka Prehistoric Women, which is not a prehistoric set movie, but they're a lost tribe of Amazon women. And she was also in two Bond movies, of course. She was in From Russia with Love and Thunderball. As a big cat fight in From Russia with Love, like a gypsy fight. And that became her stock in trade for a lot of movies. She would have these brazen, scantily clad cat fights with other vixens, and she does so in this. And so during this big celebration, they're all eating this boar, and the cast really are diving into a baking hot roasted pig and fighting with each other, and they're burning their hands and their mouths with this stuff, and it makes for great realistic, you know, scenes. And chaos ensues, and Tumac, John Richardson, ends up fighting with his dad. He's already, you know, estranged from his brother, and he gets flung out the cave, falls down a mountainside, wakes up at the bottom of the cliff, doesn't know where the hell he is, wanders off across the wilderness, encounters eight men, that aforementioned giant spider, although he doesn't really do much with that, he just sees it and fucking runs, as you would. And then he, dehydration and sunburn hits him, afflicts him, and he collapses, and he's found by the Shell people, the Shell tribe, who live on the beach. He's never seen the sea before. They live on the beach in a lovely, idyllic surroundings, and where his tribe are all shaggy, dark-haired, you know, heathens. These are mainly, predominantly blonde. And their poster girl is, of course, Raquel Welch. It's worth taking a second or two out just to imagine. Well, don't imagine, you can see it. There she is. In a tailored, fur-lined bikini set. And little fairy boots. Oh my god, she's adorable. As are pretty much all the women in this. They all are. But she was the one who actually had the tailored costume. As Martine Beswick says, hers was a bit scratty and, you know, a bit ratty and bedraggled. But that was meant to, you know, she's a bitch, you know. And he encounters these people. They take him in. He's completely barbarian compared to them. I mean, they're pretty much primitive as well. No one really speaks. There's only, you only say the other person's name, like Tumac, and Raquel Welch's Luanda? I think it's Luanda, or Luana. And there's a couple of people. But Akit is like the sound of distress. Whenever something happens, it's Akit, Akit! You know, someone's being killed over there, and you try and get someone's attention. You go, Akit, Akit! You know, I've just got my left testicle caught in my fairy zip-lined, you know, fly. Akit, Akit, Akit! You know, that is the danger word. And you hear it a lot in this, because there's a lot of danger. And he gets taken in by these, and he sees fish for the first time. He learns to swim, things he's never encountered before. He learns to smile and laugh, which he's never done before either. He saves a child. He helps the children eat fruit from the tree, because they can't reach it. He climbs up and shakes the branches so all the fruit falls down. He then puts a child into the tree so she can do the same and help her people. And so there's interaction taking place there. He learns about spears, because they use clubs and sticks and stuff like that. But from the Shell people, he learns how to put, like, let's have a little look. Here's one I made earlier. How to put a nice spike. Now that would obviously be iron or steel, and they don't have that, but they're using bone or whatever to make a sharp edge. So they're more scientifically and technologically evolved than his people. So it's give and take. And when I think it's an Allosaurus attacks their little peaceful homestead, that little girl he put in the tree is still stuck there, and while they all run for safety, he alone goes out to go and rescue her or lure the, you know, the dinosaur away to give her a chance to survive. So there's heroism, but he can't quite reconcile his own barbaric ways. And because he saved the day, and in a great sequence, he spears, you know, the Allosaurus, and he manages to, like, throw it over his head. It's a great shot. Ray Harryhausen, of course. Ray Harryhausen's stuff is immaculate in this. Immaculate. And He wants the spear as a prize, so he'll end up fighting the guy that Raquel Welch's Luana. I'm gonna get these names wrong. Doesn't really matter. And the blonde one. And they'll end up fighting over the spear. So he'll end up being outcast from their tribe as well. But this blonde guy, from whose spear it is, I think he's he's the young chieftain. He's the chieftain's son or something like that. It's all like always about siblings and father hierarchy structure in these tribal societies. Well, nothing's ever changed, has it really, on that score? Because we don't use spears now. We use nuclear weapons, you know? So he gets banished from these people. But they give him the spear, you know, going, you'll need this. And of course, Raquel Welch has fallen for him. So she goes off with him. And the two of them, they make, well, for Tumac, it's the return trip. I mean, I don't know what his plan is. Is it to go back to his rock tribe, go and teach them a lesson? No, so now I've got this. You know, very similar to Iron Master, where the outcast goes and learns how to make iron weapons, and then goes back and takes over the tribe, and his rival gets outcast. Very, very similar. And they encounter these primitive ape men in this idyllic, beautiful cave with a huge sort of, you know, Garden of Eden sort of tree growing out there. And they hide in that whilst these ape men kill each other and smash each other's heads against rocks, and then they witness cannibalism there as well. They make their escape and they meet other dinosaurs, and you know, and they get back to their tribe, whereupon Raquel Welch, the enormously ever gorgeous Raquel Welch, will end up having a big mad cat fight with Martine Beswick, who plays Nuponde, I think it is. And Nuponde was Tumac's woman, you know, initially. So obviously she's not too happy about this blonde bitch coming into the... And you wouldn't be, would you? You know, her man's come back, and he's come back with a weapon better than anybody else's. In the meantime, his brother, the Percy Herbert character, is Salamander, I don't know what his name is. He's seen his chance whilst ghost hunting with the men folk. And his father, has climbed, scaled this mountaintop, but he's hanging on for dear life. And Percy Herbert finds a way around, comes up there and sees his chance. Yeah, you sneered at me. Well, he doesn't say this, but in a little thought bubble, you can imagine it, you know, populated with lots of Uggs and Axe and Akeets. He's thinking like, yeah, you fucking shit on me, and you let that other bastard, you know, be in charge, and then you fought him, and you think you're in charge here. Well, hey, guess again. Stamps on his fingers, and off he falls to his death. Not quite, because he returns as well, but he's crippled and he's old now, and you know, he can't really fight back. So obviously, when they're getting there, he will find Raquel Welch, because she and John Richardson get separated because of dinosaur activity, and he'll try to rape her. John Richardson will, in the nick of time, save the day, but when he's about to kill him, she will stop him, because they're showing acts of mercy. Peppered throughout this, the Shell tribe have shown mercy. So Tumac learns, as well as his proper heroic skills in battle, and his noble, you know, stature, his noble demeanor, and his growing love for this blonde woman, that mercy can wield power as well. If you show mercy, you will gain the trust of those around you. So they're learning stuff, you know, as it goes on. Of course, when they get back into the bosom of all this, and again, the cat fight between Martine Beswick and Raquel Welch, which is great, famously, because they weren't insured for it. The crew said, you know, well, you know, the director said, Don Chaffee, the director, and Michael Carreras. I'm struggling with that name, Carreras. Hammer's main honcho said, look, no, you two are going to do this. We're going to get stunt women in. But when the stunt women came in, and Martine Beswick and Raquel Welch sat there and looked at them, they thought, no way on earth, because these look nothing like us. We can do better than that. They were both trained dancers as well. And Martine Beswick was a former Miss Jamaica. The two of them said, no, we'll do it. Trust us, we can do it. What a fight that is. It's tremendous. Anyone who thinks Raquel Welch, you know, won't throw herself around and they'll use stunt doubles for it, watch that sequence. Raquel Welch, by the way, had only a few months before hit the big time with Fantastic Voyage, where she and the rest of this space age crew are injected into the body, you know, of a dying man to try and save him and all that. And a famous special effects movie with Donald Pleasance as well. And so she was already like the darling of cinema, which she didn't know at the time when she was making this movie. But of course, that famous shot, that image, was leaked before the film came out. So the paparazzi were waiting for her, and all of a sudden she was catapulted to superstardom and iconic sex goddess status. But their fight is awesome. It's violent, it's powerful, and Raquel Welch wins, but she shows mercy again and will not kill this defenseless woman who she's beaten. And it's the turns, the twists, the turns, the lessons learned, all of it works. The soundtrack you're listening to is by Mario, oh God, I always get this guy's name wrong, Nam something anyway. He did a lot of biblical and historical epics, 50s and 60s. Great, he did the Vikings as well, Kirk Douglas and Tony Curtis. Yes, Ernest Borgnine, the Vikings. And his score for this is just powerful. There's a strong choral background to lots of it. There's ethnic percussion, bones and rattles are used. To get the full soundtrack, which I'd love to be playing right now, I'm playing highlights of it, which I've managed to put together. But to get the full soundtrack, it's going to cost you an arm and a leg. You know, and back in the Stone Age, that literally meant an arm and a leg. I ain't going that far for it. But it's a great, powerful, hypnotic soundtrack. The location work, Lanzarote, Tenerife, Gran Canaria, these volcanic islands, absolutely amazing. This is the most epic of Hammer's movies. Little bits are done at Elstree Studios, as I said, but most of it is external, exteriors, on location, and it looks amazing. You've got some map paintings in the background, only occasionally. You don't need them, because this rolling, black, arid landscape, it's a prehistoric husky who's just blundered down the stairs there. She'll probably come hurtling in a minute with a fresh kill. And there. But it is just, the film, even without most of its dialogue and its cliched ending of a huge volcanic upheaval and the two tribes will have to come together. The bad seas will be killed. You know, the ones who would never see eye to eye either side are, you know, stricken in the air, the devastation and the chaos. But the survivors will have to band together all the lessons that they've learned, and you're seeing society growing, you know, a fledgling civilization. But that's what you're watching. The film does seem to work as a kind of lesson. It's showing you how primitive man would have lived, his behavioral traits, how the societies would work together and obviously fall apart, and how you would learn. And as such, okay, dinosaurs didn't exist with man, but notice how I've barely mentioned the dinosaurs. Ray Harryhausen here. And the reason for that is because the film itself, even without the dinosaurs, I think is mesmerizing. Just watching John Richardson, Raquel Welch, Martine Beswick, Percy Herbert, just these people coexisting and their conflict and traversing this epic landscape is just, you know, you've seen it in Quest for Fire, you've seen it in Clown the Cave Bear, you've seen it in lots of movies, but this does it so, so well, and it's such power that it's one of those rare movies. If you look behind you now, you'll see all my favourite films. Escape from New York has a conclusion, it ends. Halloween is fucking endless, but really, you know, sequels we don't really care about. Here's the husky! It's coming in now. Well, barely. If I was open mat, you'd have seen her, but I'm widescreen. You know, all of these Jaws, Mad Max 2, have conclusions. They may have other stories afterwards, but the films themselves end at a satisfying point. that story's over. This story may end where two tribes have come together, but it's one of those rare movies where I don't want it to finish. I actually want to see more. I'm just loving the visuals, loving the music, just loving the scenes. I'm totally engrossed and besotted with it. Again, Ray Harryhausen, the dinosaurs are there, but they're not the essential part. At the time, of course, it was sold on the fact that it had stop-motion dinosaurs. And of course, you know, the first one you see is a Gila monster with fins stuck on it. But as I say, that was like Harryhausen just saying, look, I know you guys have come to see proper stuff, and I hate lousy effects where they just put fake stuff on a real creature. That doesn't look good at all. It's not what I do. But he was kind of shoehorned into doing that as a sort of like, look, audiences, this is what you expect from these kind of movies. Well, let's get that kind of shit out the way. Here's the good stuff. The aerial combat between a pterodon, not a pterodactyl, everyone makes that mistake, a pterodon, which picks up Raquel Welch, still to this day, although it's obvious it's stop motion stuff, and a stop motion, Raquel Welch was there 1 minute, and then the next, it picks up a stop motion, blonde haired puppet, but it looks great, and it flies, it's going to feed it, you know, to its babies in a big nest on top of a cliff, and Tumok's running after it, with his buddy as well, to try and save her, but it's miles away. And then another airborne creature, not a pterodon and not a pterodactyl, another one, a flying winged rhododendron, comes out of nowhere, and it's an aerial combat, and she is dropped into the sea, whereupon like Tumok thinks she's dead. She will come out obviously with a bit of an injury because it's got its claws into her side, you know. And but the animation, that is spectacular. The interaction between humans, the live action humans, and these dinosaurs, the stop motion creatures, is phenomenal. There's weight and structure and spatiality, dimensionality to these creatures. Tumok plunging his newfound spear into the Allosaurus and flinging it over the whatever the, like a T-Rex wannabe and a Triceratops battle whilst there, Raquel Welch and John Richardson are hiding in the cave. And the weight and structure of these things moving around outside, you feel it. It's clearly, you know, they're not in the same, they'd act together, we know that. But that suspension of disbelief is nigh on perfect. Of course, the film's also famous because Martin Beswick, who plays, you know, the vicious fire bitch from the rock tribe, she said, you know, and she was Hammer were using her as their new woman. Raquel Welch was going to catapult, you know, Hammer, but she wasn't going to stay with Hammer. But Martin Beswick was going to be on the books, and she got to know all the main, you know, the main supremos, the movers and shakers of Hammer. And she got a lot of their movies. But she said, I can't do this film, and she's flying out there, because I know John Richardson. I've seen him before, and I know that if me and him get together, if our eyes meet, that's it, fate, we're going to be hitched, and I don't want to do it. But they threatened to sue her. Okay, no, we want you for this part, you're coming along for it. And they did meet, their eyes met across there, the first room where she was sitting with Michael Carreras as well, and some other Hammer honchos, and they all witnessed their interaction, and the two of them got married, yeah, after this movie. They then got divorced as well, like, but hey, you know, this is what happens. John Richardson is awesome, you know, he is a BG. His hair is fantastic, his beard is fantastic, his Franco Nero, you know, pearly blues are just awesome. He is a good looking guy, there's no two ways about it. He makes big, hairy, heathen barbarians look sexy. Sadly, I make it look like a big, hairy, heathen bastard, you know, but we must make do with what we've got. I've got to say, 1 million years BC, Hammer's big time epic production, so not typical of their of what you expect from Hammer. But Hammer did do a few prehistoric movies. They did the Land That Time, was it Land That Time Forgot, or the Creatures That Time Forgot, and When Dinosaurs Ruled the Earth, and they were a lot sexier. One of them in particular had Julie Edge, a lot of chesticles were out in that. This one is definitely, I would say, family friendly, but but it's very violent. You know, it is brutal, it is dark. It does depict a dark, scary time of violence and chaos. And folks, I've got to say, I love every friggin' minute of it. Let's just show you that poster again. It's just so glorious, isn't it? And I've just ordered a big version of that poster as well. So, anyway, folks, I've been working today, so I've had to throw this together, you know. But I can soon sort that out. Woman! 1 million years BC. Two thumbs up. Classic excellence. Ray Harryhausen, Raquel Welch, John Richardson. Chaos, volcanoes, monsters, death, carnage, and lots of ugs, axe, and akits! You know it makes sense. Go and watch it now. And in the meantime and in between time, try and stay safe. Watch out for pterodons. And I'm going to see you all. Rock tribes. Shell people. I'm from the whiskey tribe. And we will not be beaten.